Hello and welcome back to this YE2 tutorial. In this video we are going to be looking at internationalisation, or in other words how to translate the content of your website into different languages and into different locales. So we're talking about translation of strings of text such as this, but also the display of dates and numbers, which obviously varies from country to country. And YE provides a lot of very useful and very easy to use tools in order to do this. But the first thing we need to actually ask ourselves as website developers is whether we really need to translate our website. And the reason that's important is because the translation adds overhead to our application, really in two main ways. Obviously it will add performance overhead, because if you store your translations in a database, there are potentially going to be a lot of database queries every time somebody visits your website. But in addition to performance overhead, there is also the management overhead of how you're going to translate all of your strings into other languages. And that's not as simple as going on to Google Translate, which might work for, you know, a single word. But when you're talking about a whole paragraph of text that has context and has meaning and has subtlety and maybe even cultural clues that will work in one language, when you translate those, they won't necessarily work in another language. And the only really high quality way of translating text is to get a human who speaks both languages in order to understand those subtleties and translate those things effectively. So you need to ask whether that is actually something that you can manage, because that is not a small amount of work, even on a very basic site. Even on this template, there are lots of pieces of text on lots of pages, and to translate all of that even into one other language is not a small job. So assuming that you do want to translate and you are interested in taking on the management of that, the good thing to note is that YE provides various functions and various classes in order to help you with the translation. And we're firstly going to look at what happens when we translate numbers and dates. So that's a very, very easy thing to do, and it actually uses under the covers the PHP underscore INTL extension. So you will need to make sure that you have that extension enabled in your php.ini. And that international extension, which has been available since PHP 5.3, is always available to YE, because YE is based on a minimum of PHP 5.4. So because that extension is available, YE has decided just to use that, which is a great idea because it gives us lots of functionality out of the box. And we access that functionality using this class called formatter. But let's start by looking into our configuration and looking really at the two most important properties as regards our internationalization. And the one that we are unlikely to change very much is this source language. And the source language is the language that all of our translation strings are in the code. So although we're not looking at translations just yet, if we take a quick peek at what the code looks like when we translate things, you can see here that we pass a piece of text as the key, and in this case the key also equals the text in English. So in our case, the source language is always going to be English. All of my messages here are all in English by default. So that is the source language, and it's recommended that you use a source language of English wherever possible, and that's just for the simple reason that it's much easier to find people to translate from English into any other language rather than translating in from perhaps a much rarer language into another rare language. So where possible, try and keep your source in English. And then this property called language is actually the target language. So this is the language that might be changed by a user, changed by somebody visiting your browser, and this determines the language that we want to display to the user on the website. So once we have those two things set up, and later on we'll actually look at a way of switching that dynamically, but for now it's just hard-coded in the configuration, If we look into our view at this date, you notice I've simply got a hard-coded date here, and I want it in a long date format. I'm just calling formatter as date. If we go into formatter, there are a whole range of functions, time, date time, all kinds of things that all take care of all the different formats that are needed in different locales. So we don't have to worry about that, but I'm saying to my view that I want to echo as date, or the output of as date for that date, using this formatter class. And if we go here and we look, that's what we have. It's simple enough, and that's exactly what we would expect it to do. So it just as a way of demonstration, if we were then to say, well, let's change our target language to French, and notice that we could use the full locale. In this case, that is the French that they speak in France, rather than the French they speak in other French-speaking countries. But we could also use the top-level French. And we go back and we refresh, and as you can see, without me doing anything else, it has translated that, including translating the month name, into French, and set it in a format that is suitable for French speakers. So if you notice, in this case, 15 comes before January, whereas in the English it was January 15, 2015. So that's really, really easy, and there's almost not much more to say about the formatter. There is also a set of variation of these functions. So in some cases, you don't necessarily know whether a value is a date because it's from a, let's say, a database table. So you've also got a set of other functions that you can call, or a function called format, where the second argument is the type. And so if the type is stored as data rather than in code like this, then you can pass that in as a piece of data and achieve exactly the same thing. So go and take a look at that. Test it on the different date formats that you're using in your active record classes, just to make sure that the formatter can handle those formats. Otherwise, you obviously might need to convert them. So that's all we really need to say about formatting. Most of the rest of it kind of just works. And like I say, that's all built into PHP and is not using any of Yi's functionality. So that's fantastic. But now we need to move on to the much larger question of how we translate text. So in this case, at the minute, that word welcome, if we go and look in here, is just hard-coded in a header one tag. Now that's fine, but obviously that's not going to be translatable if it's just hard-coded in a file somewhere. So if we ditch that and instead replace it with this, now you'll see this everywhere because this is a function right in the base level of Yi itself. So this is not even a function in app, this is a function in Yi. And that T is T for translate. And the two arguments that we pass to it are simply a category and the key, which is usually the English text that we want to display. So in this case, app is the default category that Yi uses for any messages that appear in your web application. And there is another one, another category called Yi, which is you will find all around the framework classes underneath vendor. And they are obviously for built-in Yi messages, and translations are already provided for most of those messages in lots of languages. But in this case, you can create other categories if you like, but for now we're just going to stick with a single category called app. Now, what's going to happen here, if we now go back, we should still be in French. If we now go back and refresh this, then we get the French for welcome, bienvenue, which is great. And if we change our language back to English again, and go back and refresh, it now says welcome, and the date has also changed back. So in terms of the actual the usage of your translation mechanism in code, it's dead easy. Yi, colon, colon, T, category, and value. And that value can be very long. We'll see some of these more clever ones later on. And like I say, the category can be whatever you like, but you need to be careful when creating new categories, because by default, if you create a new category and don't have a category file for it, then you'll get an error rather than just it ignoring the translation. So we need to be a bit careful of that. And the other thing is you can use E colon colon T in things like your model classes. So where you have display labels and stuff like that, if we look here, hopefully anyway, where do we go? No, bad example. Look at user. Oh no, it doesn't have any display details either. This definitely does. So if we look here, even within the model, we're still using E colon colon T just to translate these into other languages. Now, these might not actually need to translate. So if you were translating into German, perhaps ID would be the same, but that's okay. What we're doing here is we're saying we're not going to assume that a code is going to be the same in another language. We're just going to pass it to the translation mechanism, and it's up to each of those translators to decide what to do with that. So that's the consumption of the translation data. So what we're going to look at next is how we actually set all that up in our application, how that all wires together and where that comes from. And so we're just going to have a look in here at our configuration. So if we scroll down a little bit, we will see this component called I18N. I18N is just an abbreviation for internationalisation, because it's a bit quicker to say it. And you'll notice that under the translation section of this, then we're saying that for every message in an app category, so we can use subcategories as well if we want, but anything that starts with the word app, we're going to use a PHP message source. And this means that we're going to store the translations in files. And then there's some setup which basically sets up a file map saying, if you're looking for the category app, you will find it in a file called app.php. And if you're looking for a category app/error, you'll find it in error.php. And you can set this up however you like. It doesn't really matter too much. But clearly, if we leave it to be fairly conventional and match the category to the file name, then that's obviously going to be easier to maintain. And although the example I'm showing is for PHP message source, there is a DB message source which uses database tables. If you want to use the database source, and I'm not convinced that it's very good performance wise, but if you do want to do that, if you look under the framework classes and under internationalization, and if you open up DB message source, you'll see in the comments at the top, it will tell you what tables you need to create. And hopefully you should be able to work out how to use these. But effectively, that's the category like app or ye. That message is the key, so that's the thing in English. And then for each language, we have that integer is just automatically assigned. We have a language, which is our English or English French, English American or French Argentina or whatever it might be. The translation itself, so that will be the translation in the other language, and then that ID there ties into that ID, so you should be able to work it out, and I'm sure there are probably plugins, but the basic idea of it's still the same. We can look at the PHP message source, and I think if you can get away with it, the PHP message source is going to work more efficiently, because all we're talking about then is loading a local file into memory, and it will, if you enable it, you can cache it as well. And that just means that you're not going to the database all the time for lots of different things. But it does potentially mean that if you've got a lot of languages, you will also require a lot of memory on your server. But again, you will only really be able to tell that by testing. So by default, we go to a messages folder in our app, and you'll notice straight away that you have a set of folders. I've created three, but you can clearly create one for each different language that you want to support. So I've just really created some very basic examples. I have one for Russian, that's all variations of Russian. I have one for French Moroccan, and I'm not actually sure if that's the correct code, but I was just using it as an example of how that works. And then I've got one for French. So each of these has an app.php, and inside each of those, we simply return an array with the English key on the left-hand side and the translation on the right-hand side. We'll look at this one later on because that's a bit of a clever thing. What I've done just for test purposes is said, well, let's assume that in Morocco we don't spell bienvenue with an E. Let's say we spell that with an A. And then we can just demonstrate how the cascading of languages works. And then clearly in Russian, we've got, dobro pozhaluta, which is, again, all in Unicode characters. So that's all ready to go. But the key is all the same and it's all in English. So if we go back to here again, and let's say we're going to set our language to be French Moroccan. So we save that and we go back and we refresh the page. Now what it's done is it said, okay, I've found an exact match for that Moroccan French and I've spelt bienvenue with an A instead of an E. Again, I'm not sure if that's actually correct. It probably isn't. It's just an example. But look what happens if I change this to say I want French France and I refresh. Now it's showing me here the French version. Now you might say, of course, that's correct. But if you look, there isn't actually a folder that matches French underscore FR. So what Yi does automatically, if it can't find an exact match, then it looks for a match just on the first two letters. And in most cases, that's going to be close enough. So as we mentioned earlier, there are lots of variations of things like Spanish. But if you didn't have, for instance, Mexican Spanish, most Mexicans would be able to understand Spanish, even though some of the words are different and some of the grammar is different too, but it's probably close enough. So Yi does that automatically. So that's great. Now there are a couple of clever things that you can do with the translation strings. If we pop here and have a quick look at the guide, there's one on GitHub, you can also find it on the Yi framework pages. There's a tutorial-i18n, and this talks about all of this localizing and translation. But imagine the case where you've got a string that's like, you know, hello username, and of course the username could be whoever's logged in, it could be different. You obviously can't translate that for every different username because that would take far too long. So what you can do is you can put in these little curly brackets and you get a placeholder. And then using this version of Yi colon colon T that takes a second parameter, which is an array, you can tell it to replace username placeholder with some kind of variable. Now in this case, you might say, well, why don't you just use Yi T for hello? And then maybe afterwards just join on another string saying, you know, username at the end. But again, that's making an assumption that it's going to work the same in every language. Because in some languages, maybe you would say Alexander, hello, rather than hello, Alexander. In which case, the translator has the ability to modify that, move the username bit to the start and put their word for hello at the end. So you've got some flexibility there for placeholders, and that's data that you're not going to know at translation time. And it also allows you to use numeric placeholders. So in this case, you're not using an associative array, you're just passing in the values here. And again, you might find that neater than using a named placeholder. And then there's a whole section on formatting numbers and patterns and dates and all that kind of stuff, which is all really useful because, again, what you're doing here is you're mixing the functionality of the translation mechanism with the functionality of the formatter, which will ensure that all of these will look suitable for the current language that you're displayed in. But one of the ones that I wanted to look back at is the idea of plurals. And this is something you might not be aware of, but in different languages, plurals work in different ways. So in English, we have usually one form of word if we have one of them, like one cat. And then if we have zero or more than one cat, we would use the version cats with an S on the end. So we only have two forms of plural, cats, cat and cats. The other thing that we do differently is when there is zero, we use the word are because we use the plural form of cats. So again, that's something that we do in English that you don't do in other languages. And in fact, in languages like Arabic, for instance, there are three forms of a word for singular, dual or plural. So again, you can't always translate the same text in the same way for different languages. When you look at other examples, like saying Russian, even the actual form of how you address the cat, or using a pronoun for it or whatever, is going to kind of change depending on whether you're talking about here, we've got few, we've got many, we've got other, we've got all of these different forms of cat in Russian, which again doesn't just directly translate from the English. So you have a whole mechanism here to actually calculate what the plural should be for different languages. And if we go back here, what I've done is I've actually added the plural example from that guide into here for Russian and for French as it happens. But I want to look at the Russian one just as a kind of example. So if we go back to English here, and if we enable these that I have commented out, and then we go back to our app front page. So in English, this is the correct form. There are no cats. There is one cat. There are five cats. So that's all correct. And what's important here is that's not kind of hard coded for 0, 1 and 5. They're numbers that I'm actually passing in to the, everything else is the same, and the Yi translator is actually working out the correct form. So if I put in 0, it knows it needs to use that text in there. If I do 1, it knows it needs to use that. And if I use any other number there, like for 5, it knows that it can say are 5 cats. And that's exactly what it's done. And then what's clever, and in exactly the same way as you would imagine, is if I change that to Russian and go back, we get exactly the same thing. We get all of these different forms for cat. So we have katov, we have kat, and we have katov there as well. So the plurals are singulars, and even these additional words that might be needed in different languages are all taken care of with that mechanism. So that's really cool as well. Let's go back to English quickly. So the next thing I want to look at is the functionality that you can use to actually find out whether you have missing translations. Now this is kind of important, certainly in debug mode. You can kind of say, well, I want to know on a page, when I visit a page, am I missing a translation? So what the translations, what i18n allows you to do is pick up this missing translation event and direct it to an event handler. So I've created my own event handler here, that one there, and I've got I handle the missing translation. And again, this is the same as the example on the guide if you want to find it. What it does in this case is it says, if I'm in development mode, and if the translation is missing, I'm going to add some extra text to it, to the page directly. So although the page won't read very well, it will be nice and easy if a translation is missing. Now, if I go back here and I load up English, because my source and target language are the same, and this is really important, no translation takes place. So it doesn't go to the database and ask for the English translations of the English strings. The assumption is that the source messages are already correct. Now, if that's not true, and if for some reason you've decided not to use, let's say, English text as your keys, but let's say you're using a number or something for whatever reason, then in your configuration for the translation for here, you have to set force translation to true. Otherwise, it won't go and translate those things. But what happens now if I go to Russian instead of English and I refresh? You can see here that if I just pop back here and look at our index again, if you look a bit further down, what I've done is I've replaced just the first heading with YT. The rest of this is all hard coded, so I'm not bothered about that. But I've replaced the first one with a key called heading. And if we look in our Russian file, we see we have no translation for heading. So if I now go back here, we'll see that my missing translation handler has made that really nice and clear and obvious on my page. So I could test all my pages. I could look, I go, oh, we're missing a key here. So if I'm missing a key, I could go back to my Russian app. I could go to the end here, add another translation. And I have no idea what heading is in Russian, so let's just say it's heading. And if I go back and refresh, it's now found that translation, or what doesn't really look like a translation, and it's put it back in. So that can be really helpful in terms of debugging stuff. And what I've done is I've wrapped this in this key, which is only set in development. So again, this is something that you could use in your development environment, but not deploy to the real world. But again, management wise, you need to ask, what do I want to do if I'm looking at a page in Russian and there are three words in English? Do I need to find that out somehow? Have I got a way for those to be reported? Is it going to screw up my whole site? You know, they're kind of questions that are not really to do with code, but they are kind of important questions. So let's just ditch that because it's nonsense. So we've looked at that now. The next question really is how we actually handle the setting of that language. So clearly at the minute in here, I've hard coded it in the configuration, but that's not really much use for somebody coming in from outside who wants to view the site in Russian or Chinese or whatever. So there's a couple of things you need to be careful of really. The browser language can be quite useful. So people have their browser set to be a certain language, and that's probably a good indication of the language that you can display your site in. However, that's not perfect, because perhaps I've visited, I don't know, an internet cafe in Japan, and I'm using a Japanese computer to access, you know, my Facebook or whatever it is. And I don't want that just to be displayed in Japanese, or if it is, I'm going to want a really nice, easy way of changing it. So whether you use the browser language or not, if you translate your site into multiple languages, you're almost certainly going to need a language selector. So I've knocked something up myself. I'm not sure if there's an extension for this somewhere, and I'm sure I haven't exactly done it in the nicest possible way. But if I go back to the view, so where was I on site index? Is that where I've done it? Oh no, sorry, in my layout. What I've done down here is I have created a widget, and the widget's called, in my case, Language Selector. I've put a kind of few HTML elements just to try and put it in roughly the right place, but that's all pretty rough. I wouldn't normally put styles directly in code and that kind of thing, but it will serve well enough for now to demonstrate what's going on. So App Components Widgets Language Selector. If I go into there and have a look at that, all this really does is it gets the current language setting from configuration. It gets all of the languages from params. So what I've done in here is I've added a set of languages. Now, at the minute, I don't have translations set up for all of these. But just an example, you know, these are the locale code. So Spanish and Chinese and Hindi. Arabic, Portuguese, that kind of stuff. And so these here are basically a configuration to say what languages the user is able to choose. So I grab those, add them to two variables, and then pass them to a view. And this view is like a partial view, which basically creates a form and then makes the a set of languages, either using links, this top bit doesn't work anymore anyway, or a drop-down list. And by putting it in a form, it means I can cause an AJAX post to occur when somebody changes the language. And the way I've done this, again, it's not necessarily the right way to do it or the best way to do it. I've created an action on my site controller, which this AJAX post calls. And when that returns, then this function here tells the current page to reload itself. So wherever I am on the site, it will reload the current page, but with the changed language. The actual action in the controller is fairly straightforward. I've set it so it's post only. And that's just to stop people, you know, finding it with a get and making it all go a bit funny. But if you look here, all it does is says if the post variable is set, which of course it should be, and if that selected language exists in languages array, because it might have been removed, then we set the language in the config. We then, more importantly, drop a cookie, and we set that cookie in the response, and then end our action, any whatever happens. And this cookie is really important because setting a configuration variable is only valid for the current request. Because when somebody comes back again, you know, with a new request to reload the page, then all of that config is going to be deleted. It will be reloaded from the configuration file, and that language setting will be lost. So we set a cookie here, and then that's all fine. But of course, the other thing that's important is I need to make sure that when the page then loads again, that that value is taken from the cookie and set back into that variable so it works properly. So if I go here to my language handler, so this is a third class, this is Ye2 style, so it inherits from behavior. And I basically attach my behavior to the application before request event. And that means this will be called every time somebody requests any page, which again is important because I obviously want to set the language whatever page the person's visiting. And again, in this case, all I do is I say, if I've got a cookie with a value for language and that value exists in my array of languages, then I set it in the configuration property. So that's all fairly simple. And that wires up automatically, so that's all really quite straightforward. And then one last configuration change in order to wire that up is down here we use this syntax to effectively attach my handler class to the before request event. So that's all fantastic. And now that I've uncommented that, if I go back here and load this page again, we will see now a little drop down list on the right hand side. It's set to English at the minute, obviously, because it's in English. And if I change it to, say, Russian, then what's happened is going to reload the page, and it's reloaded all of those strings in, which is great. One of the things to be careful about, I've seen it done a few times, is obviously if somebody comes to this site and it looks like this, not this, looks like this, and the person's Russian, and they kind of think, oh, well, I can't read this because I can't read English, I want to change it to Russian. If they see a language drop down and all of these are written in English, then it's not necessarily going to be very helpful, because if they can't read English, they're not going to know which one says Russian. So it's important that each of these languages is actually written in their own language. So if you're choosing, you know, things like you know, Japanese or whatever, you can just pick that. In this case, there won't be any translations, but you know, that they can read that in their own language. So that's really cool. So hopefully that now shows you pretty much all you need to know. I mean, I mentioned briefly about the database. Again, there's an amount of caching that is carried out with the messages, but you do need to make sure that you enable caching in the Ye configuration in order to actually use that properly. And obviously, if you have a lot of messages and you have caching turned on, then there's a good chance you might use, you know, a good couple of hundred meg maybe of memory to actually cache all of those translations. But as with most things, just test it, do a load test, try it with a fake number of users, just keep exercising it, and rather than assuming that it will or won't perform properly, just work it out just by trial and error and by testing. And like I say, the work required to put it into the database is fairly minor, but then you've also got additional questions about how you're going to get the data into those database tables, how you're going to update them, how your translator people get access to that, whether they send you text and you paste it into the database. So again, a whole load of management questions, but hopefully you've seen the fact that it is really quite straightforward to do this in Ye. And again, if you want any extra help, go and find that tutorial, i18MD. There's quite a lot of stuff in there. quite a lot of stuff about translating different things, and then a few of the more fringe examples of translations. But other than that, I hope you've enjoyed that, and I hope that's been useful for you to work on your internationalisation. So I look forward to seeing you in the next video. Any questions or comments, please put them underneath. Thank you.